Hi folks, my name is Alex and welcome to Any Given Saturday. Today I'm joined by Matt Moscona, host of the Daily Sports Talk radio show After Further Review, along with the LSU post-game show Whiskey and Wine and Morning Scone. Matt is a six-time honouree by Radio Inc., among top local sports talkers in America, and a five-time recipient of the Louisiana Association of Broadcasters Prestige Award for Best Sports Talk Radio Show. In 2004, Matt graduated from LSU with a bachelor's degree in journalism and has been working for Guaranty Media in Baton Rouge for 12 years. Thank you very much for joining me today, Matt.
Hey, Alex, my pleasure, man. Thanks for having me.
Awesome. So let's start then with your time at LSU as a student and your journalism degree, if that's okay. What was the inspiration behind doing a journalism degree? And why did you pick LSU as the institution that you wanted to attend?
Yeah, so I'm from Baton Rouge and actually had a little detour. A lot of my friends were going to LSU. I kind of wanted to do something different. So I spent a year up in South Bend, Indiana. I wanted to go to Notre Dame, but apparently you have to be really smart to get in there. That's a caveat that was difficult for me. So I worked really hard for my 3.4 GPA, but that wasn't enough. So I actually went to school at Holy Cross College in South Bend, which is run by the same priests. And it's a feeder school. And I did really well. I actually made a 4.0 for two semesters there. But I always say it was the football, the food, the women, and the weather, and not necessarily in that order, that sent me back home. So I transferred to LSU. It was the best decision I ever made. I always knew I wanted to do broadcast media, graduated in journalism from LSU, but I really thought I would do news. I love sports, but sports was always, as a career, kind of trivial to me, at least as a young person. So, I was in school during 9/11, and when you have one of these sort of, world altering, transformative events, that was very impactful as an aspiring journalist and broadcaster that, I thought that's what I would do. I would do news. And I did news radio for about 4 years, the first 4 years of my career. And, turns out I hated it. So I switched and did sports and I loved it. And it's what I've done and been very blessed and fortunate to cover teams that I love and live in my hometown where my family's here, my wife's family's here, and get to do something every day that doesn't really feel like work.
Sure. No. That's fantastic. Did you play any sports at LSU whilst you were there?
I didn't play at LSU. Right. I played football in high school.
Right.
And near the end of my high school career, I had some interest from smaller schools, but for me, it was more, I kind of wanted the college experience. And to be perfectly honest, I was in no way good enough to play at a major college level. So it was go small school just to keep playing a sport that I love or get on with life. So I got on with life.
Sure. And what position did you play in high school?
I was an offensive guard. So when I was recruited as a fullback, about 6 foot, 230 pounds, pretty strong, kind of an athletic pulling guard type. So there were schools that thought, hey, look, it'll put your hand in the dirt, give you a 3 yard running head start and let you be a lead blocker. Nobody uses the fullback anymore. So, I might've been a dying breed at that point in my career, but I basically used my head as a battering ram for the bulk of my childhood.
Sure. And how would you say sort of the college experience was for you at LSU?
Oh, I loved it. It was the best decision I ever made. Outside of obviously marrying my wife and my child, but I mean, in my young adulthood and adolescence, LSU was, it's so strange to have lived so long in Baton Rouge, to have attended sporting events at LSU forever, but never really touring the campus or learning much about the university. And as a student, to walk the campus as beautiful as it is, to have learned the history of the university, the journalism school is one of the oldest accredited J schools in America. It's a great, great program. I loved it. I mean, I love the Stately Oaks and Broad Magnolias. I fell in love with LSU every day I got to walk on campus. I'm so prideful. I mean, of course I want LSU sports teams to win at everything. I mean, I'm an alum. If there's tiddlywinks, I want us to win the Natty, but mostly I love LSU, the institution, because it was so formative for me at that point in my life. It was where I figured out what my career path was going to be. And, where I grew up in so many ways. So I love it. It's mine and I'm its, you know.
Oh no, excellent. Excellent. And what was the first LSU game that you attended then?
Oh God, you'd have to go back to like when I was a child. Like, right. I mean, so when I was born in New Orleans, and on Saturdays, we'd get up on Saturdays and my dad would drive us up. I have a brother and a sister, and we'd drive up to Baton Rouge and we tailgate on the old front nine. We go to games. I mean, I remember, like, I have faint memories of games in the 80s. Like, you know, LSU played Miami in a torrential downpour in 1988 in Tiger Stadium. I remember sitting in the rain. I don't remember the game. LSU got crushed. I don't remember the game at all. I was 6 years old, but I remember sitting in the rain at that game. I can remember going to an Alabama game, you know, early those days, early 90s. I remember my dad had a torn ACL and he and I went to a year LSU played Tennessee. It had to be 1991 or 1992 in Tiger Stadium. And he's, you know, walking up Victory Hill on crutches, getting into the stadium because of torn ACL. In Tennessee walloped LSU that day, as most teams did. My first memories of games were bad LSU teams. It was the end of Mike Archer and the Curly Holman days. Those are the games I remember, the games. So not a ton of great memories as a kid, but as a student at LSU, my years at LSU were Nick Saban's years. Sure, so sure. I had a great time at LSU watching football.
Sure. And do you remember the first game you attended actually as a student? Or were you kind of a bit drunk at that point?
Yeah, I mean, it was the 2001 season opener against Tulane. On the first play of the game, LeBrandon Tofield took a carry like 65 yards. I think they scored in two or three plays, but absolutely. I mean, as a student, I went to every game home and away except for the 2001 game against Mississippi State and the 2002 game at Kentucky, which was the Bluegrass Miracle. Right. I was not there because the year before, it was a weird scheduling quirk where 01-02, the league changed the rotation. And so LSU played Ole Miss at home back-to-back years and played at Kentucky back-to-back years. So I went to Lexington in 01 and LSU won on a late touchdown pass from Rohan Davey to Michael Clayton, I believe. And so I was the next year, I had an event in Baton Rouge that day. And I was like, well, I went to Kentucky last year. I don't need to go again this year. And lo and behold, it was the Bluegrass Miracle. So that was one of two games I missed actually being in person during my college career.
Sure. Oh, man. That must have, I presume your friends kind of made a bit of a joke about you having to miss that one. But
Well, I was at a banquet so I did a college job, and the banquet for the summer internship was that day. And it was at the Crown Plaza in Baton Rouge. It wasn't called the Crown Plaza at the time, whatever it's called now. And I had an ear, like, I mean, this was old AM, FM, you know, Walkman radio earpiece in my ear, listening to the game. And the banquet wraps up as Kentucky kicks the field goal at the end, which you think ends it, right?
Yeah.
And I turned the radio off. Our banquet had just ended. So we're all just sitting there kind of like bummed that LSU was going to lose. And in the lobby of the hotel, they have a bar, they had a TV in there. And a few minutes later, we just hear this like eruption, the screaming, and people are running through here going, they won, you know. I'm like, you gotta be effing kidding me. Like, don't play with my emotions. You know this. But lo and behold, yeah, that's how it transpired. So I was not listening or watching to that play live. I turned it off.
Yeah. Wow. What was some of your favorite games to attend as a student? Is there any that kind of stand out? Not necessarily maybe the biggest ones, but just.
Oh no! I mean, look, the whole 2003 season was incredible. I mean, obviously the first national championship in 45 years. You know, really dominating Alabama up there was a lot of fun. Of course, the national championship game and everything. I'll tell you the ones that stand out. The 2001 season. When LSU won their first SEC championship game title, when they beat Tennessee, you know, that was the year where the 9/11 happened. And so the Auburn game that was scheduled for September was moved to December. And so that Auburn game was actually an incredible memory because for LSU fans, Atlanta and getting the SEC championship game just always felt like forbidden fruit. It was like, right. That's for other programs. It's not for us.
Yeah.
And LSU had had years under DiNardo in 96, 97, where they tied for the West, but lost the tiebreaker because they either lost to Bama or Auburn in that given year. So, when they finally beat Auburn to punch their ticket to the SEC championship game, that was incredible. We all rushed the field. And I'll show you. Bear with me one second. Sure. I'll show you this. I keep this on my shelf. So this is a picture of me and my buddy on the field. We're smoking cigars because the last time they were in Tiger Stadium, Tuberville lit up the cigar in 99. And I got a chunk of the eye of the tiger in my hand from the field, from turf. And that's the turf. I keep it in a jar. Wow. And that's the cigar that I didn't finish smoking because I was, a college kid and didn't know what the hell I was doing smoking cigars. But I still have the dirt from the field of that game. I mean, it's, that one always kind of stands out. And then obviously the high points, the lowest point would be the 2002 Arkansas game, the miracle at Markham, where if LSU beats Arkansas, they're going back to the SEC championship for the second consecutive year. And Arkansas, I think, completed two passes all day. And then all of a sudden, ding, dang, bing, bang, bomb. They're right down the field. And DeCorey Birmingham catches a touchdown pass as time's expiring. And that happened right in front of me. And I was sitting at the, first row at the goal line. Happened right in front of me. Got all these Arkansas kids flipping us off and everything. It was Little Rock is the worst trip in the SEC. So, but that was a low moment.
Sure. And I guess just kind of transitioning, as we've already talked about it just a bit, but what was it just like to be a student at LSU winning the national championship, and just kind of the emotions and just everything pouring out from people just within the state of Louisiana winning a title after over 40 years?
Yeah, I'm going to be curious to see how the 03 championship holds up, because we've been so fortunate, right, to watch LSU win a second in 07, to play for another one in 11, to have the most dominant season ever in 2019. I'm going to be curious how history remembers the 09 champion or the 03 championship. Burrow, and that was so magnificent. It's in a whole different stratosphere, but the emotion of 03 was, I think, unmatched, because there were so many people, so many LSU fans who lived and died without ever getting to see it. You know, I mean, 1958 until 2003 was 45 years. Yeah. And a lot of people thought it could never happen. So that's what, you asked about the emotion. I mean, hell, I got to watch that game in the Superdome with my dad and my brother. The three of us went. And man, I had a cigar in my pocket. By 03, I had learned actually how to smoke a cigar, unlike in 2001. That's why this one's in the jar. When Marcus Spears, I don't know if you remember the game, but LSU was up 14-7. And when Marcus Spears intercepted Jason White and had a pick six, and that put LSU up 21-7, I pulled out my cigar and I was third quarter. I'm waving it around this is over, because I just knew that defense. Was not giving them the two-score lead. They were just by the time they got to the end of that season, they were just so elite and next level, and there was just nobody was going to score on that defense. So cried tears on the ramps of the Superdome walking out, as I'm sure many grown men did. The elation of being on campus, the championship parade that they had. All of the souvenirs and collectibles on campus and around town. You'd have these pop tents that would pop up on every street corner selling championship merchandise. It was just, everybody was just devouring whatever they could to just marinate in that moment that we had waited so long for. And to be a student on campus during the time was really special. They've been able to experience that as a senior at LSU was awesome.
Sure. Yeah. If you can, could you sort of describe for someone like myself who's yet to visit Tiger Stadium what the game day experience is like, the tailgating, and just the LSU culture?
Hold on. You got all this LSU stuff and you've never even been?
It's incredible. I know.
Tiger Stadium is, and I don't want to disappoint you, but I'm going to be very honest, and the LSU fans don't always like to hear me say this, but Tiger Stadium is like almost any other venue in this respect, that as college athletics in particular, but all athletics really, have become more and more corporate. And as the home viewing experience has gotten so good, it's been a challenge to create a tremendous atmosphere regularly. When LSU plays Central Michigan on a Saturday, it's not going to be that fun. I mean, there's going to be 20,000 empties and maybe more than that. And people are going to hit the exit soon. And it's that ain't great. But, and here's the caveat. Tiger Stadium is still to this day, and I think will forever be, as good of a big game venue as you will find anywhere in sports. When it matters, and look, when you've had the success LSU has, the games that are actually going to get a fan base to engage and matter become more infrequent, right? Whenever you're unranked and you haven't been ranked and you have six straight losing seasons and you play the 15th ranked team in the country, well, beating a top 25 team is a big deal.
Yeah.
LSU now is expected to win all of those games, right? Sure. So when you have a top five matchup, when you have the 2019 season when Florida came in was unbelievable.
Yeah, just watching that on TV, you could feed it off the screen.
Those types of moments, 2012, the TJ Yeldon play when Bama came in and beat LSU on that game winner at the end. Those types of games, there's still no venue like it. When the stands are full well before kickoff, you live and die with every play. The emotion is palpable. Like, you have this nervous angst with every play, and you emote at the end of every play, and it's 100,000 people and all the fanfare. And LSU fans know when to make it count. They know when to make it count.
Yeah.
And it's special when you get those. They don't happen all the time anymore, but when you get them, they're special.
Yeah. No, it's interesting. I'm probably one of the bigger LSU fans outside America, and yet the college game that I've actually been to was Stanford in 2019 when Northwestern came and did a non-conference game tape in the season. So yeah, I'm still waiting for my time to visit Tiger Stadium.
I remember that game. It was the Smart Kid Bowl is what it was. Stanford and Northwestern.
Yeah, yes.
All the smart kids got together to play football.
Just kind of transitioning into something else briefly. I'm kind of always interested in the ways in which sports and kind of just life and life's challenges can intersect with one another. How important would you say LSU's on-field success from 2005 to the 2007 National Championship kind of in bringing enjoyment and positivity to the people of Louisiana and the state kind of still recovering from Hurricane Katrina? I realize kind of naturally we tend to associate the Saints and their role and, you know, that kind of 2006 game against the Falcons as being, you know, a kind of a massive landmark kind of achievement. But would you say that there was kind of the same with LSU in terms of bringing back optimism and happiness to people's lives?
Yeah, it was. You know, the LSU opener that year in 2005 was displaced. It was moved. They were supposed to play Arizona State in Baton Rouge, and that game got moved to Tempe. And LSU played a home game in Tempe. And I remember they painted the end zones for hurricane relief and donated all the money for hurricane relief. And that was actually Les Miles' first ever game that he coached at LSU. It was a beautiful preamble for what was to come, because he faked a punt out of his own end zone. He faked a field goal. Like, it was the most bonkers, you know, Jamarcus Russell hitting early Doucette to win the game. Like, I mean, it was so appropriate considering what the next 12 years of Les Miles would be, that was the opener. And then, that day, that Saturday was impactful in a vacuum, because it did give people a respite. It gave people because immediately post Katrina, you couldn't turn off the 24-hour news channels, and all anyone was looking at was the devastation of New Orleans and much of the Gulf Coast, family members who had lost homes, lost everything, who had lost family members. And it gave you a respite. It gave you an excuse to turn off the news and turn on something that would be a complete deviation, a complete distraction, even for 3 hours. And that season was much like that. Now, the next week, they played on a Monday night against Tennessee. And that was because Hurricane Rita was coming in. But the bizarre, you know, circumstances surrounding that, you know, LSU's playing Tennessee in Tiger Stadium, where across the street, the Maravich Center, they've got, you know, evacuees housed there. Across the street at the track facility, you know, the National Guard is landing Black Hawk helicopters as they're still evacuating people out of New Orleans. I mean, it was a triage center there in those facilities. I mean, that's all happening literally across the street while this football game is taking place. So it was a strange contrast, because you had these coexisting realities where you have this emotional football game, this fun thing. And then, I mean, literally across the street was a reminder of the devastation that was happening. And LSU lost that game. They blew a 21-0 lead at halftime. And that was also very appropriate for Les Miles. But but yes, that season was and then they didn't lose again after the loss to Tennessee until the SEC championship game where they lost to Georgia. But that season was an opportunity to disengage from everything that was happening, even for a little while on Saturdays.
Sure. Yeah. That's powerful. Just hearing that, as you're saying, the football game on one side of the street and evacuees on the other, kind of thing.
You'll see it when you come to visit. You'll see how close it is. I mean, it's just a 2-lane street separating the football stadium and the basketball facility. I mean, you could hit it with a baseball, just, you know, or a football if you had a good enough arm.
Yeah.
I mean, it's that close.
Yeah. Wow. Transitioning then to your time graduating from LSU, kind of how did you end up going into radio work?
So I started radio while I was still in school. I knew I always wanted to do media, and so I was just applying for jobs with every local media company. For a brief while, I wrote box scores for The Advocate, which is the newspaper on Friday. I'd go up on Friday night, and you'd have high school coaches, whatever, that would call in their box score and their stats for their high school game, so they'd be in the paper the next day. And so I'd take those calls and, you know, format them for the paper. I just knew I was going to be in media. And so I started kind of just cold calling. And there was one radio station, the GM at Citadel Broadcasting, Rebecca Breeding, agreed to meet with me. She said, you know, sent her a resume. She agreed to meet. And in hindsight, I realized there's no reason for a general manager of a radio station to meet with a college kid. There was just, you know, way bigger fish to fry than a fool with me trying to, you know, get some type of job or internship. But went and met with her. We talked for about an hour. And she said, well, we're not really hiring, but I always believe as a manager, you find a way to keep good people. And we're going to find something for you to do. And so she hired me. She hired me as a part-time promotions intern, which basically, you know, whenever radio stations, you know, go out on remote or have promotional pieces, I mean, that's what I did. I loaded up the station vehicles. I sometimes went and gassed them up. I cleaned out the prize closet. I even changed light bulbs in the radio studios. It was just, I did whatever they needed me to do, but there was my foot in the door. Because whenever they didn't have anything for me to do, I would just go into the radio studios and just ask the people who were on. I was like, "Do you mind if I just watch? I won't bother you. I just want to watch and learn." And so many people were receptive to it. I'm very grateful for those experiences. And you know, it didn't take long because I was there for about 3 months, and you know, I basically learned if you're willing to do the crappy jobs that nobody wants to do, when the good opportunities come along, you're going to be the first one they think of for that opportunity. And that was the case with me. So I was there for about 3 months, and they had a news talk station, and they were hiring a new morning show, and they asked me if I wanted to produce it. So that was my sort of entry point into full time work on a live radio show. And so that started me for about 4 years into news radio. And I'm grateful for that experience. It's really what set me on my journey to where I am now.
Yeah. And then how did you then go from that to AFR now?
Right. So that was around, so I was there from 2003 until, so 3, 4, 5, 03, 04, 05, 06. And then in 2007, I was done with news, didn't want to do it anymore. I was actually going to move to Atlanta to launch a Catholic radio station associated with a school. I'd been hired to do that job. I put an offer in on a house and all kind of stuff. Well, in the interim, I had a few months before I was moving, there was a sports station in Baton Rouge, The Score, 1210 AM. And the program director was a guy named Matt Kennedy. He knew of me from being in radio in town, and he needed part-time board operators. I mean, like entry-level stuff, but I didn't have anything to do. And I was like, okay, I got a couple of months. Well, and he had me board opping on the sports station. And the job in Atlanta fell through, and I mean, it was almost football season, and that station had a weird gap in programming, because a lot of times on a station, you'll have national and local programming, but it was weird where the lunchtime show ended at 3 o'clock, but the afternoon guy couldn't get there until 4 o'clock. So from 3 to 4, it was like, well, do we go to a national show just for an hour and then come back to the local? Or so he asked me, he's like, do you want to do a 1 hour show? And just basically do that hour every day from 3 to 4. So I said, sure. I mean, I had nothing else to do. So I hosted a sports talk show called The Fastest Hour. It was me and another guy, Josh Innes. And we did that from 3 to 4 for a couple of years. And while I was doing that show, my current employer, Guaranty Media, they had the idea brewing of launching an ESPN affiliate in Baton Rouge on an FM. And Gordy Rush reached out to me and said, I was actually walking into Tiger Stadium before a game in 2009 into the press box. And Gordy saw me and said, hey, look, I want to talk to you about an opportunity, a job opportunity. I was like, okay. So he called me the next week and he said, listen, we're launching the ESPN station and we want you to be our afternoon guy. And I said, okay. I mean, I was doing a 1 hour show, working part-time, probably making 18 grand a year. So the opportunity to have anything stable and full-time and was a great opportunity. So I took it, and they gave me a blank canvas. It was a when they launched that station, it was the previous format had about a 0.1 share rating. I mean, there was no audience, there was no revenue, there was nothing. It was just, here you go, kid, go get them. I was 27 years old, and I just grinded away and have for the last 12 years. And it's kind of amazing what that station has become. I mean, it's one of the highest performing ESPN affiliates in the country. It's one of the top billing stations in this market, which is unheard of for sports. We've been fortunate to win a lot of awards and be syndicated now in New Orleans and Alexandria, and hopefully more to come. I mean, it's been, in many ways, it's felt like a lifetime, but in some ways it feels like it's been a blink of an eye that these 12 years have gone just like that. But hopefully many more.
Sure. And do you remember the first topic that you covered on that very first AFR show that you did?
No, but I'm going to guess I know.
Right.
Because it was February of 2010, we missed the Saints Super Bowl by a week. So the Saints win the Super Bowl and we didn't launch until the week after. So we could have launched the day after the Super Bowl. Had we done that, that would have been incredible. Saints win the Super Bowl, our first show was the day, but it was actually then a week later.
Right.
So I'm going to guess we started with talking about the Super Bowl.
Sure.
What I do remember about the first ever show is all of the suits, like all of the executives from the company, were all standing there outside of the studio looking through the glass. I mean, it's a fishbowl, right? I mean, it's glass where people can look through. And they were all standing there looking at it because they wanted to be there for the first, you know, they made this big investment in flipping the station and building the studio and all this stuff. And they hired me and nobody knew who I was. And like they were there. I mean, I remember that vividly. And the first guest ever on AFR was Mike Scarborough, because it was right before National Signing Day. And we had Mike on the show. He would have been maybe the second or third segment we did. He'd have been the first ever guest.
Wow. Well, that's good memory, I guess.
It's funny the stuff you remember, because I mean, look, Alex, over 12 years, if think of it this way, right? Over 12 years, if you do roughly 250 shows a year, right? I mean, you're talking 3,000 shows. I'm not very good at math, but you know, let's say I've done 3,000 episodes of AFR. Is my math right on that? No, that's gotta be wrong. Hang on. I need to calculate. Are you good at math? I'm terrible at math. Hang on. All right, let's see.
I haven't done it in a while.
250 shows times 12 years. So 3,000, right, times 3 hours a day. That's 9,000 hours of radio, wow, on AFR. You know what I mean? Like, that's a lot of hours. 9,000 hours of radio is a lot of hours of radio. People come up to me often and they're like, hey, oh, do you remember that time? I remember when you did this. Or I'm like, sorry, I don't. Like, it's impossible to remember everything. You know, like, there's people I've interviewed on the show, like, yeah, I remember you had me on the show. I'm like, I don't. I'm sorry. I'm not being rude, but it's just, there's no way you can remember all of it. It's like a it's like a baseball player that plays 162 games over a decade and be like, hey, do you remember every at-bat that you ever had? Well, no, it's impossible, right? But there are things and shows and interviews and topics and things like that do stand out for sure.
Sure. kind of transitioning to LSU football and the 2022 season, what has Brian Kelly done that's kind of impressed you the most so far?
Well, you know, he's a winner. Everywhere he's been, he's won. And you don't have that type of success in that many different stops if you don't know what you're doing. He knows how to build an organization and structure a staff and all that. So I'm not surprised in any way that he's hired a good staff and, you know, and is head down working to rebuild the roster. I'll tell you the thing that's been reassuring, I think, is when he came in and he uprooted everything. I mean, not only the on-field staff, but I mean, all the way down from, you know, analysts and recruiting staff to the people that answer the phones. I mean, they have replaced everything there. You know, Louisiana is a place, though, where the great advantage is you're in a talent-rich state and you're the only Power Five here. So there are kids that just want to play at LSU. They grew up here and want to play here. But you have to be invested and rooted in the high school culture in this state. It's very familial, the way the high school coaches all interact and get along. So you have to have guys on staff that have a connection here, because he doesn't. You know, and that was Corey Raymond and Kevin Falk and, you know, guys that he had on staff, Mickey Joseph, who filled that role in recruiting. They're all gone. And so Brian Kelly could have said, look, I'm just going to do it my way, bringing guys I know from my staff and other places. But what he did instead was he had some of that, but he also hired a bunch of guys with ties to this state, you know, to go get Frank Wilson, to go get Cortez Hankton, to retain Brad Davis, who's from Baton Rouge. You know, that's all of that is really impactful, because you got to have those guys that are rooted here. You know, Joe Sloan has spent 10 years in Louisiana, up at Louisiana Tech, and he recruited primarily Baton Rouge and New Orleans. So you've got guys that know this state, that have the relationships in this state, that can open doors in this state, that are going to make that transition for him that much easier. And they're also great coaches. So I think that's probably the most impressive is his willingness to humble himself and to acknowledge where, you know, he and his staff might have had, you know, some blind spots and to basically fill those.
Sure. Yeah. And it seems like he's done a good job as well of re-recruiting the roster, you know, holding on to guys like Ali Gay, Jay Ward, getting Baskerville back for another year.
Yeah.
It feels like those are the kind of guys maybe in the past that a couple of them would have just gone on to the NFL, and instead they're now going to be really key pieces on the defense, you know, this season.
Yeah, there weren't many to re-recruit, man. Yeah. So many. Yeah. The roster was so depleted. But no, but you're right. I mean, Baskerville's huge because you're just so thin at linebacker.
Yeah.
So you get Baskerville back. You get Mike Jones to return. You add West Weeks, the transfer from Virginia. All of a sudden, you look and you go, okay, you got pretty good numbers there.
Yeah.
You know, Ali Gay is an elite prospect at a premium defensive position. So it's always great when you get that guy.
Yeah.
You know, to return for another year. Yeah, absolutely. And then what he's done in the transfer portal has been out of necessity. I tell people all the time, Alex, like, it's not going to be like this every year. I mean, they're not going to go recruit a dozen kids a dozen transfers every year. He has to this year because he just doesn't have numbers. Yeah. If you want to be competitive in 2022, you got to put guys on the field that have played college football before. I mean, you can't recruit 25 freshmen on a roster that only has 50 scholarship players right now. You're 10 under the scholarship limits, or there about, and half your roster's freshmen. Like, you'll get annihilated in this league.
Yeah.
And they ain't paying Brian Kelly to get annihilated. So he had to go hit the transfer market hard this offseason. And then he's done it well.
Yeah. No, for sure. And also, you know, retaining and holding on to some of the high school commitments as well, I think it's been quite impressive. You know, you do see that whenever there's a coaching change, you know, kids then decommit and for whatever reason. But it's certainly very impressive, I think, what he's doing with the numbers and how things are kind of looking so far. For the Tigers that have declared for the upcoming draft, how do you think they're kind of going to fare in the process? And you know, do you kind of see maybe players like Damone Clark and Flott, who seem to do a really good job in kind of increasing their draft stock this season?
Well, Stingley is going to be a top 10 pick. And sure. I know there's a lot of fans who were upset with how his career and time in Baton Rouge ended, but I don't blame him. I mean, look, every spot that you drop in the draft costs you about $1 million.
Right.
Based on the slot value. So Derek Stingley, if he had gone and played on a bum foot this year where he needed surgery, would have only continued to see his play regress.
Yeah,
he lost himself money. LSU fired its coach halfway through the season. The administration punted on this year. And then had he had surgery after the season, that would have cost him the opportunity to train for all the pre-draft process at the combine and pro day. Derek Stingley is a magnificent player. And we should all be collectively grateful for the role he played on the greatest team that any of us have ever seen. And wish him luck at the next level, because he's going to be fantastic in the NFL. Flott and Clark are easily the two that have most dramatically increased their draft stock. And I think both of those guys are going to be day two picks. And Damone Clark has a chance if he goes and test read at pro day or the combine, you know, runs a 4.3 or whatever, he's got a great chance for someone to fall in love with him and be a first round draft pick. Not 4.3 would be absurd, but you understand what I mean.
Oh,
he burns up the clock, and you know, he could be that guy. Cade York is probably going to get drafted, which you don't always see for kickers. I'm interested about the offensive lineman. I think Ed Ingram is a talented enough guy to get drafted. He just had a lot of inconsistent play.
Yeah.
And then there's guys that you probably won't hear their names called that have a chance at the next level. You know, Austin Deculus played a ton of football, but I just think when your body's that battered over 5 years, how much will you be able to pass the medical? Same with a guy like Andre Anthony, who's coming off a torn ACL. You know, it'll be fun to watch these guys. I think you're going to hear a lot of Tigers names called in the draft. They're just not going to be high picks aside from Stingley. And then you mentioned, you know, Flott and Clark, probably day two guys.
Sure. Yeah. Who do you see having a kind of a breakout year this upcoming season? And do you think there's any true freshmen that could compete for playing time potentially?
Well, they're in desperate need for cornerbacks. So if either LaTerrence Welsh or Jordan Allen can come in and play right away, there's an opportunity. Now, I don't know, because I'm not the guy that watches high school film, and I'm not a scout. I can't tell you if he's quick twitch, turn the hips, or like, I don't know.
Sure.
You know, so, but what I do know is LSU's got two cornerbacks on the roster right now, you know, who were here a year ago.
Yeah.
And neither of them played. It was Demaryius McGee and Ra'Darius Jones. So that spot's wide open. I mean, if any of these cornerbacks can come in and play, let's see it, Hoss. I mean, we're ready to see you. We need, you know, this LSU needs it. You know, I think you always look at the top of the rankings. I think Walker Howard is going to redshirt this year. I've spoken to his dad about it. They're open to it. I mean, Jamie played at LSU. He knows the challenges of being a young player trying to play in the SEC at that position. And if it goes badly, how the fans can turn on you. I think they're content to let Walker grow up a little bit, watch, progress naturally. It's just, it's a great benefit having a smart dad who's been there, done that. Will Campbell will be interesting. Emory Jones will be interesting. I mean, you lose four starters on the offensive line. Now, they've added a couple via the portal, but there's no guarantees. So you have four starters that are no longer here. There are four spots open. So the offensive line is one spot I would most definitely point to there. And keep an eye on Noah Cain in the transfer portal as well at running back, because
Penn State.
Yeah, from Penn State. Baton Rouge kid who went to IMG Academy. You know, Ty Davis Price had a nice second half of the season, but none of those guys back there really have done anything. We can be optimistic about John Emery. I think Corey Kiner can be a good back. I don't really know what to expect from Armani Goodwin or Trey Bradford, but Noah Cain is a power five running back when he's healthy. He's a good power five running back when he's healthy. I think that's a guy that's going to make a big impact.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, certainly, as you said, at running back, there's talent. It's just not, they've just not proven themselves yet, have they? For whatever reason, whether it was inconsistencies in O-line play this season we've just had, and even the season before that, or for whatever other reason, injuries, and with Emery, with the academics and things like that. So it's going to be fascinating to see how that kind of shakes out over the next few months, and who's going to be the guy. Because there was times where TDP had a couple of great games, but you still never felt at times that he really elevated himself.
Yeah.
To that next, you know, like to be the LSU running back from the tradition of the position and the guys who've played it before.
Mm-hmm.
It's a long way away yet, and a lot can happen between now and September. But I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on the LSU and FSU game in the Superdome. I think it's worth noting as well that it's the first time that both programs have played each other since 1991. So that was quite a while ago.
I remember that game as well. It didn't go LSU's way that day, but not much did back then. But yeah, I mean that, and that those Bobby Bowden teams in the late '80s and in the '90s were just magnificent. Where they had like 11 straight years where they finished in the top five. Florida State was awesome, but I as much as we are uncertain about LSU. I mean, the same can be said about Florida State. I don't have their roster in front of me. I don't know all that they're replacing this year, but boy, they have just been a giant ball of inconsistency since Jimbo Fisher left there, cycling through after the stability of Bobby Bowden for four decades, you know, to have the instability post Jimbo that they've had has been kind of amazing. It does really expose a lot of the issues at Florida State, where if it's facilities or fan support or recruiting issues or budget to keep staff and stuff, you know, that's sort of an uphill climb there at Florida State. I think talent wise, LSU probably have a slight edge over them. I certainly like Brian Kelly over Mike Norvell. And those two played to open this past season. Notre Dame played for Florida State, which ended up being a great game.
Yeah.
Notre Dame held on late to win it. So there's probably a little advantage there for Brian Kelly, having scouted this Florida State team and knowing a lot of their talent. And the fact that it's in the Superdome will be a massive home field edge for LSU that day. So it's preliminary. You know, Alex, a lot of people say, hey, what do you think the record's going to be for LSU next year? I'm like, I don't even know who's going to be on the team yet.
Yeah.
they got to finish this roster. I mean, Ed Ogeron just decimated the roster and it's, you know, I need to see what else they do. And remember, even in 2018, when they got Joe Burrow and Cole Tracy, I mean, you didn't have those guys. You didn't have Joe Burrow. He didn't get to campus till June.
Yeah.
So you're still going to have even more roster turnover post spring, because there's always another wave, right? You have spring ball and guys don't like where they are on the depth chart, so they transfer. And I think you're going to see that with this team as well. So we're far, far, far from knowing what the final roster is going to look like for LSU. So it's really hard to start to predict what they're going to be in 2022, because I don't know who they're going to have just yet.
Yeah. No, I mean, we don't even know what the team is going to be like in a week's time. I mean, just with what's going on the portal right now. And so as you say, it's impossible to predict for September. Would you recommend going to that game? Because I remember I've talked to LSU fans about this in the past, and I was really trying to go to the game at the Rose Bowl, UCLA, but everything, travel and everything, COVID completely wrecked it. I'm very glad I didn't go with how it ended up. I mean, I think it finished here at 6 or 7 in the morning, so it was quite a late one for me. And then I remember watching your post-game show, and I was just dying laughing.
That was a great trip until the game. And unfortunately, I've said that too many times about LSU. Like the trip against Wisconsin and Lambeau Field, amazing once-in-a-lifetime trip to go to Lambeau and to tour and the LSU fans that were there and the LSU-Wisconsin back. It was so much. The whole thing was great. And then they kicked it off, and you're like, what am I looking at right now? Why is this LSU team with 4 first-round draft picks and 20 NFL players losing to Wisconsin? But anyway, Les Miles, which is why he's no longer here as well. But yes, look, I go to that game, sure. I think you're going to have it. I'll tell you this. It's the start of an era. It's the first game Brian Kelly will coach. So you can always say, look, I was there for Brian Kelly's first ever game. And you get a chance to go to New Orleans, which you can always find a good time in New Orleans.
Sure. No, it's interesting, because I remember I got quite a bit of pushback from people saying your first LSU game has to be in Tiger Stadium, like it can't be anywhere else. But at the same time, the idea of seeing the Tigers playing in New Orleans, I think, is quite cool. And certainly cool. Being the last time they're in that building was a national championship. So
you should fly in November and watch LSU against Alabama. I don't know how it'll go. LSU will probably lose that game, but that's one that's always worth seeing. If you want the Tiger Stadium experience full throat, that's probably going to be the best atmosphere. That's going to be the one. It's going to be hard to get a ticket, but that's the one.
Sure. And have you got any thoughts kind of on the other non-conference games this coming season? So they're playing Southern, New Mexico, and UAB. I mean, certainly UAB, if you look at what they did this season, could potentially present a challenge. The Blazers went 9-4 and then capped the season off with an upset over 13th ranked BYU.
So Bill Clark's done a really good job at UAB since they canceled that program and then sort of rebirthed it. They've been a really solid Group of Five team. LSU shouldn't have any problem in that game, though. New Mexico, they're one of the worst programs in the FBS. Southern's interesting because it'll be the first time we see LSU and Southern, the crosstown rivals, playing. For a long time, leaders of both schools have avoided that game because you just didn't want the strife in the city of, to be quite honest, I mean, there would be a racial divide as well, because you're talking about predominantly white LSU and an HBCU in Southern. But my hope is sincerely that becomes a unifying day when LSU fans and Southern fans commingle on the LSU campus and both bring all of their tailgate and their pride. The game is going to be a total blowout. Southern can't stay on the field with LSU, but as FCS teams shouldn't be able to. It's just a different reality. But my hope is for the city that manifests into a beautiful day of cultures coming together, where so often we see this divide at the LSU campus. I mean, quite honestly, south of downtown is LSU, north of downtown is Southern. And it will be, I hope that's going to be that'll be a great day for our city with both communities coming together on campus.
Sure. Yeah, no, that was going to be my follow-up question, just how big is the game for the city of Baton Rouge?
I think it's really significant. And there was one other day that I remember. And in 2003, to sort of bring this back full circle, in 2003, LSU won the national championship. And in 2003, Southern won the Black National Championship. And the mayor at the time decided they were going to have a parade for simultaneously for both teams. So it was a parade that went through downtown Baton Rouge and other parts of the city. And, you know, there were the players from Southern and LSU were just all together. It wasn't like a Southern parade and an LSU parade. They were all together. And you had players from both teams on the same vehicles. It was just fans all together. It was a day of just extreme pride for the city, not just for one team or the other team or one fan base. So that it was just everybody, if you're young or old or black or white or male or female or Southern or LSU, you were just coming together to celebrate something great for the city. And I do hope that's what happens on in September when Southern comes to Tiger Stadium.
Sure. I've just got a question just kind of about NIL and the transfer portal. Could you potentially see a scenario play out in the future where group of five schools almost kind of become farm systems for bigger programs? So for example, a UL Lafayette or Louisiana Tech would, you know, perhaps develop kids who didn't get an offer from LSU or were maybe deemed too small or not quick enough or, you know, not good enough at the time. And then they then actually then start to develop and grow and become good players and then would then transfer to LSU. Could you see that potentially happen?
I think you're already seeing it. Yeah. Kyron Lacy's a wide receiver from ULL who's now an LSU wide receiver. Makai Gardner is a cornerback from ULL who's now an LSU cornerback.
Sure.
I think absolutely that's going to happen. And I think that that's a very natural, and that's nothing to do with NIL. That's more to do with the new transfer rules where you have a one-time transfer waiver where you can go wherever you want to play immediately.
Yeah.
And that is going to happen. I mean, you're seeing that, excuse me, not just within state schools, which will happen. But you're seeing that with guys from Louisiana who didn't get the LSU offer out of high school, who left and are now coming back.
Yeah.
There's two guys from Arkansas, Gregory Brooks and Joe Fouché, both from New Orleans, who didn't have LSU offers, go to Arkansas. Fouché is a four-year starter and a team captain. Gregory Brooks is a three-year starter. Both of them are leaving. Arkansas won nine games this year. LSU was sub 500, got a new coach. They both left Arkansas to come to LSU because they want to play at LSU. So, I think you're going to see that continue. Absolutely. I mean, it is the inherent advantage that LSU has. You're the only Power Five in a talent-rich state. Kids who are born here want to play for LSU overwhelmingly. And if they ever get the opportunity, they're going to take it. Even if you leave to go play somewhere else, you don't stop being an LSU fan if you grew up your whole life cheering for LSU. And if you have the opportunity to come back and play for LSU, you're going to do it. Yes, you're absolutely going to see that happen.
Yeah. Do you see what kind of other position groups do you think the Brian Kelly and the staff are going to target in the transfer portal? I mean, just kind of looking over what they've already kind of obtained and the holes still on the roster. I mean, maybe a center, unless you feel kind of confident about one of the guys already.
Well, you know, and Tremont Shorts, the lineman they got from East Tennessee State, may play center too. So I think you have Charles Turner and Tremont Shorts. Look, if a guy that's been an all-conference center somewhere pops up and wants to come to LSU, you take it.
Yeah.
But I think the most obvious position where they still need help is cornerback.
Sure.
You've got safeties, and you've bolstered the number of defensive backs. We mentioned Fouché and Brooks, who have transferred in. Jay Ward played safety last year, but can also play corner.
Sage Ryan there.
Sage Ryan could play. He played nickel safety last year. Could play both. You're going to get Major Burns back healthy at safety. But when you're talking about guys that project just as a true outside cornerback, I mean, you only got two. I mean, you got the two we talked about, Radarius Jones and Demaryius McGee. That's it. Yeah. And then you signed, the two in this class already with LaTerrence Welsh and Jordan Allen. And then you brought in Makai Gardner from ULL, who's a smaller corner, but still an outside cornerback. If there's someone, and look, there's a kid right now on the transfer portal from Oklahoma State.
Yes, who, I saw that.
Who's a kid from Louisiana from North Louisiana, who didn't have an LSU offer, but has been a four-year starter at Oklahoma State, was all Big 12 this year on a great defense. LSU's on him, and if that kid wants to come here, he's a day one starter here. He is a day one, he will start against Florida State. So I think that's the most obvious spot right now is they've got to get help at cornerback. And I think at tight end as well, because you sign, Mason Taylor.
Yeah.
You got Cole Taylor as well.
Yeah.
And Jack Mashburn. That's it. I mean, you don't have a legitimate tight end threat. So if you have an option, as much as Brian Kelly throughout his time at Notre Dame used and utilized the tight end, if there's an option there, I think you need tight end help too.
Yeah, sure. The last couple of years for the LSU program have certainly been a roller coaster. You could describe it, I guess, with a lot of things. But what's it been like just kind of covering the football program where they just really never seems to be a quiet day? And there's always a story, it seems.
It's good for radio.
Yeah.
It's really good for radio. Because 12 months out of the year, you have content. 2019 is obviously way more fun than years like 2020 or 2021.
Sure.
But that's the nature of the ebbs and flows of covering a team where you have good and bad and ups and downs and highs and lows. But you know, LSU is, I think what I would love to see for LSU is stability, because Ed Orgeron certainly didn't bring that. And Les Miles, I think, while he won a lot of games, I think we could sort of universally agree that they underachieved. They should have won more with less, considering the talent that they had.
Yeah.
So I think the hope is with Brian Kelly, you got a guy that can continue to recruit at a high level, that's managed to have a sustained level of success everywhere he's been, but that also avoids the underachieving years that we've seen too much in Baton Rouge.
Sure. You just mentioned it, but what was the experience like in general, just being able to cover the 2019 on a daily basis? You know, did it feel like there was just kind of something special in the air around Baton Rouge just that season?
Not at the start of the year. Right. I think the Vegas win total for LSU that year was 9.5 over under. So we're maybe thinking, you know, they'll be 9-3, 10-2. Maybe a great year. They end up 11-1 and kind of, you know, if things fall their way, I think there was maybe a hope there. But when they beat Texas, I think is when you started to look and say, all right, let's see if they can start to string some together here.
Yeah.
And then when Burrow was putting up the numbers he was in September, you started to look and say, okay, this is incredible. Is it sustainable? And the answer was going to really come when they played Florida. And so when they played Florida and in that amazing game and Burrow did what Burrow did all year, I think that's when you realize, oh, there's nobody that's going to stop this offense. Like this is NFL talent playing college football right now.
Yeah.
And at that point, you knew that the only threat was Alabama at that point. So to answer your question, not initially, but I think that question was really answered when they beat Florida. When the offense got off against Florida the way they did, you realized, oh yeah, this is special. This is going to be really fun.
Sure. Yeah. Now I remember I was in Los Angeles when we played the Texas game, and it was quite funny. I was at a bar called Barney's Beanery. It's kind of a famous Los Angeles landmark. And it was just really funny. I was the only LSU fan in the bar, just there with my parents. And it was just full of Texas fans, must have been in town for the weekend. And it was quite funny, just the ebbs and flows of that game and the reactions of the Texas fans after it.
You had a good day.
yes. And it was interesting as well, because then like it was kind of split up. So there was majority Texas fans, then me just being the one LSU fan there, and then the other corner of the bar was the it was a really good game actually. It was North Carolina State against Miami, and that one kind of went down to the wire as well. Yeah. And that was kind of split 50-50 between both fan bases, so it was just an excellent atmosphere. How has the sports talk and the radio industry, how has it changed kind of since you first started? Presumably podcasting and the influence of social media have been big factors.
But that, I mean, that's the biggest part of it is the digital disruption in the industry is, it's changed everything, because it's no longer preparing a show just for the live audience from 3 to 6 p.m. Central Time. It's understanding that you're preparing a show that also needs to be repurposed into digestible audio and video clips to be repurposed on YouTube and via podcast. And you also realize that your competition isn't just other radio stations anymore. It's literally anybody. Look at right here, the barrier to entry in this industry, the barrier to entry is zero. I mean, it used to be like, even when I'm still a young guy, but you know, I've just been in the industry during a transformative piece. I mean, when I got into radio, I mean, you had to have someone like quit or die to get an on-air opportunity, to get on mic. I mean, it was just, there's only so many hours in the day. There's only so many stations in that format and so many opportunities to be on air. So those opportunities to get reps were few and far between, and they were precious. So it's been, I mean, we have seen the greatest transformation in the history of this industry. I mean, yeah. as transformative as from, you know, when TV came around and you switched from radio to TV, I mean, it's I would say even more disruptive than that.
Sure. And do you have any advice for anyone looking to get into sports journalism, sports media, and radio work as a career?
Yep. Do what you're doing right now.
Sure.
it understand, like, just start.
Yeah.
If you don't know how to do a podcast, there's a great website. It's called Google. Search, how do I start a podcast? And do work and understand that nobody's going to listen to you at first. Nobody's going to watch you at first. And that's okay. Everybody starts at zero. But if you're consistent and you produce content and it's good content, you'll grow an audience. And it doesn't mean that you're going to be Dan Patrick or Jim Rome or Colin Cowherd or who, you know, whoever, fill in the blank. But there's a career in this business for people if they really want it. But because it's so competitive, good people get driven out of this industry all the time because they're not patient. I mean, I'll tell you, Alex, I worked for 7 years with a college degree before I got a full-time job. And that full-time job was when they hired me to do After Further Review, and they paid me a base salary of $24,000. This was the year 2010. 7 years with a college degree, and you finally get a full-time job and it's paying you $24K, brother, like, that's a grind. Yeah. Not many people have the stomach to wade through that and the patience. But if you do, if you're patient and you produce content, it'll break for you. And if you're good enough, it'll break for you. But most people, the advice is produce content and be patient. I mean, it's I'm oversimplifying it, but that's what you have to do.
Sure. No. Thank you very much. I've just got one last question for you, and I thought this might be quite fun to do. If Ed Orgeron was a whiskey, what whiskey would he be? And the same for Brian Kelly. If he was a whiskey, what whiskey would he be? And take the, with Coach O, take the ups and the downs with that. And I guess the same with Brian Kelly. I know well that you're a whiskey guy, and just throw this one at you.
Yes, I'm a whiskey guy, indeed. So my initial thought is to go, okay, well, Ed Orgeron is a Cajun. There's a whiskey called Cajun Cut. And Brian Kelly is Irish. So just go with up there is the right. Fighting 69th. That's an Irish whiskey, which has a great backstory to it, connected to LSU and our military. I'd recommend anybody to check it out. But if you really wanted to go just based on like popularity and profile, I would say that – I want to give you a good answer, which is why I'm thinking about this instead of just blurting something out. With Ed Ogeron, the reality is he's not a very good coach. He's good at what he does, which is recruit. He's a good defensive line coach, but as a head coach, not good at all. So I'm thinking, okay, what's a whiskey that's good for what it is, but doesn't have a great profile? Something like hang on. Now I'm gonna look around and actually give you a review. Look at all this stuff here. Now I'm gonna stick with what I told you, that Cajun Cut, which is not a good whiskey at all, but it is Cajun. It's got Cajun in the name, and it's a bad whiskey. So I'll give you that one. And then Brian Kelly is someone who's had tons of success and just hasn't quite reached the pinnacle. So I've looked not at my top shelf, but the next shelf just below, and I'll give you something like Elmer T. Lee. That's Brian Kelly. Brian Kelly is Elmer T. Lee, which is right here. One of my absolute favorite whiskeys. Of the mash bill too, which is Blanton's, Elmer T. Lee, Hancock Reserve. Elmer T. Lee is my favorite of the mash bill twos. But people love Blanton's, and there's other things that have better marketing and all this sort of stuff, blah, blah, blah. But that's my favorite one of all. It always holds up. It's do a blind taste test. People will choose it. It's a magnificent whiskey, and it should get more credit than it deserves more credit than it gets. How about that?
Sure. That's an excellent answer. Thank you.
It took me a while to get there, but I gave it to you.
Is there anything else you'd like to add before we wrap this up? I know you've recently just started a new podcast called LSU Daily.
Yeah, thanks. I did the Locked on LSU podcast for about 3 years, built it up, and then my company launched its own podcast network and said, hey, we don't want you to do Locked on LSU anymore. We want you to do a podcast under our network. I'm like, okay, well, I mean, when you work for someone, you don't really have the choice in the matter. So I had to step away from Locked on LSU and essentially start over. We'll talk about patience. I mean, even this far into my career, there's still some element of that. So yeah, so LSU Daily is a brand new podcast. I like to say it's AFR, my 3-hour radio show, condensed into about 20 minutes. So if you want sort of 20-minute digestible LSU content, LSU Daily, wherever you get your podcasts.
Sure. Excellent. Well, thank you very much. And thank you, everyone, for watching this. This has been another episode of Any Given Saturday. And thank you so much, Matt, for your time.
My pleasure, Alex. Thanks for having me.